Whatever tracking technology you use for external load monitoring with athletes, whether that's GPS, IMUs, optical tracking or local positioning systems, the array of metrics available can be overwhelming. So today we're going to talk all about analysis of the data and how you can go about choosing the metrics that you use as well as the type of analysis you do. My name's Jo Club. I'm a sports science consultant and I support teams, organisations and practitioners all over the world with sports science. In my last video, we talked all about the different types of tracking technologies, as well as considerations for how to go about collecting the data. So if you haven't checked out that video, maybe have a look at that one first, because now we're gonna assume that you have those processes set up and we're gonna move on to talking all about the analysis. So this was the paper that the first video was based on, Tracking Systems in Team Sports Back to Basics, led by Lorena Torres-Ronda and published open access in Sports Performance and Science Reports. But now we're going to talk about this paper in Sports Medicine Open, a narrative review of applications of the data and sport-specific analysis. I'll pop a link to the paper below so you can refer back to it at any time. And we were really proud of this paper, especially because despite challenges, as always, with getting papers accepted and published, this ranked in the top 5 most downloaded papers in Sports Medicine Open in the first 6 months of 2022. But despite the benefits that tracking technologies can bring to your program and your sports science support, clearly one of the biggest challenges to deal with is the vast array of metrics available. So a first step in trying to simplify the array of metrics available is to think about them in levels. And we have presented them in this table that, using the levels that were first proposed, I believe, by Boucher and Simpson, thinking about level 1 being these simple total distance metrics, level 2 being related to changes in velocity, so acceleration, deceleration, change of direction, and then level 3 focused on these accelerometry derived measures, which may be a player load or a body load measure, as well as some of the impact or collision data that accelerometers provide. Plus, nowadays we're seeing more and more of these hybrid measures that maybe combine these different sources. So generally speaking, for external load monitoring in team sports, it's worth considering a mixture of metrics that represent total volume, some kind of distance or player load, measures of high speed in terms of volume as well as the maximum amount hit, as well as some measures of changing in velocity, and these often higher intensity but lower speed demands like accelerating, decelerating and changing direction. Plus, we want to consider the intensity of those measures. But we have to consider the sport specific context to really identify what metrics may be best suited to our environment. If we consider for a moment linemen in American football, for instance, is using high speed running as relevant a metric for their positional demands as it is for some of the other positions on the field? We have to really consider the dimensions of the playing area, the player density, the positional characteristics, as I just mentioned, as well as the rules of the game and some of the time features of the game to help us determine which tracking technologies metrics may be most suited to our sport. For example, peak speed or maximum velocity is seen as an important metric for both performance and injury risk. We've talked about how it has been described as a vaccine for hamstring injuries in field-based sports with these bigger dimensions and more sprinting involved. But it warrants critical consideration whether the court-based sports, such as basketball and netball, should focus quite as much on tracking maximum speed. The time structure of the sport may also be really important. And in this figure, we are representing not just the length of time of the different periods, but also whether these are continuous or intermittent play-by-play sports. Whilst per minute data can give us an insight into intensity in some of the field-based continuous sports. Again, we need to critically reflect on whether they can be used in the same way in sports that are broken up into these specific plays and have TV timeouts interrupting the gameplay. I'm not necessarily suggesting that intensity has no place in those sports, of course, but perhaps taking the full half and dividing by time is not a suitable approach in some sports like it would be in others. Okay, we spent a bit of time there talking about the differences across sport and using a critical process to reflect on the demands and the context of your own sport to determine the best approach. But we also wanted to think about what are the overarching applications of tracking technology data that can be used pretty much regardless of the sport. We felt there were these three key applications for tracking technology data analysis: describing the demands of the sport, using the data to help with planning, and then using that information in an ongoing fashion to monitor the athletes. But of course, none of these applications stand alone. They are all overlapping. We use the descriptions of the sport and the understanding of the demands that tracking technologies can provide to help us with planning, whether that's planning a session or an entire season. We have our plan, but then we monitor the outcomes. Again, seeing this overlap between planning and monitoring. And then we use our ongoing monitoring data to update our descriptions of the sport or positional demands. And particularly at the moment with the evolution in women's sport, for instance, we're seeing rapid development in the physical demands. And so updating our understanding of the description of the demands of the sport is really important, especially in those quickly evolving sports. But we don't just use these applications over a single time frame. And this triangle inverted in the center of the figure represents the different time frames that we might conduct our analysis over. Looking long term at seasonal analysis, or even multiple seasons, particularly if we're dealing in youth development, all the way down through monthly, weekly, daily, but also then drill level analysis, as well as trying to drill down into specific intensities. This is a whole nother debate in itself in terms of using rolling 1 minute. Sometimes this has been referred to as worst case scenario, which has come under a bit of criticism. And for more on that, you can check out my video and my blog that I've written discussing this criticism, ultimately trying to drill down to understand the most intense passages of play, whether that's in training or competition. So in the paper, we go into much greater detail around these peak demands and as talk about time series segmentation as well, which may be a technique sports scientists can use to overcome the problem of trying to make continuous time series data into these segmented portions. The remainder of the paper is spent focused on sport specific analysis. So we're taking those main team sports shown in our earlier figure about context and breaking down some of the challenges with the context of that sport and how this might affect our sport specific analysis. So for instance, in American football, we discuss how it is an intermittent play-by-play sport with very varied positional demands and how it can be challenging to quantify the contact load, and how we also have to consider the special teams portions of the game, whereby players not only have their primary positional roles on offense or defense, but also have to serve roles on special teams portions of play that can often be vastly different in terms of physical demands to their primary roles. Special teams is also something we talk about in ice hockey because of those intense periods of play in the game, but also the nature of that sport being on ice and the impact that that can have on the tracking technologies and our analysis. The rotational nature of ice hockey is also something reflected in Australian football and basketball, bringing challenges to the analysis of those sports in terms of players rotating on and off the field or the court or the ice. But as we already talked about, we have challenges at different ends of the spectrum with those kinds of sport, with Australian football having a particularly large playing surface, the challenges that brings to the tracking technologies compared to these smaller, more dense in terms of players, playing areas for basketball and also for netball. And finally, we talk as well about rugby, both in terms of league and union, and much like American football, the challenges in particular that the contact nature of that sport brings, as well as then finally soccer, which perhaps is the sport that people and this kind of analysis are most used to. But again, we have to consider the sport specific context and how that is changing over time. I already mentioned women's football physical demands evolving. We've seen recent changes to the rules in substitutions, initially because of COVID, but they seem to be sticking around. So how does that impact both our analysis and then our interpretation and our interventions with the data? So that's a quick overview of the contents of this paper, all focusing on team sport specific analysis. And hopefully if you work in one of these sports, it can bring really good value to you in terms of thinking about both the context of your sport and how that influences how you analyse data from tracking technologies. So check out the paper in full on Sports Medicine Open with the link below. And the next video, now that we've spoken about these external load metrics, we have to think about how we can combine that with our internal load measures. So keep a lookout for that video. I hope you found this video valuable to your processes as a sports scientist. If you did, I'd love it if you'd hit subscribe and keep a lookout for my next Sports Science Insights video coming soon.